So I offered your mom today to come and sit in with us and do an episode about speeding and speeding tickets. And I told her it'd be really cool to have me tell my speeding ticket stories while sitting next to a retired cop. And she just laughed, and I go, no, I'm serious. And she hasn't responded to me yet.
We'll get her in here.
Yeah, we just need to drag her over here one day. So welcome to Storytelling on the Plains, folks. We missed last week. One of our co-hosts here was sick. And then when he got better, we decided to try out some portable equipment that we got so that we can go out and do things on site. And I'm a dummy. And
didn't work out.
Yeah, it didn't work out. It would have been great, but I didn't read the directions ahead of time, and the receivers are set to permanently off when you get them. And so you had to connect them to the app on my laptop and turn them on. So now, literally, when you turn them on, they start recording.
Oh, okay. So they work now.
Yes.
So I'll have to go back.
Yeah. And the only weird thing that I'm still trying to figure out that we'll have to test out is you can have split channels or merged channels. And I really want merged channels, because otherwise, if we're there talking and I stop talking, like when we were at Legacy, you know, we kind of split off from time to time and we're looking at two different things. And if we're going to trim that down, I need the exact bits to trim down on both files. So if they're just merged together, I don't have to worry about that. I think I have it all figured out, but
we shall see.
Yeah. I'm not totally sure. And I don't foresee us really being separated like that.
No.
When we go out.
We stayed together pretty much.
Yeah. It was just every now and then I started reading something and you had wandered off and you were like, oh, Irene's reading something, and you came back. So, you know, we'll just have to do another walkthrough.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's an amazing place. And I would love to, you know, heck, we could even just sit down and talk about your impressions of the museum, because you were there as a little kid. You experienced things as a little kid when it was just the Farm and Ranch Museum, and then when it merged with North Platte Valley Museum, I think it was called. Well, when the two of them merged together and became Legacy of the Plains, you hadn't been there yet, so that was kind of cool. But we definitely need to go back out there, at least for the Charles Simmons pictures. So anyway, sorry folks that we did not get an episode out last week, and it came to crunch time. It was like 11 o'clock on Tuesday night, and I like to get it out by about midnight.
Yep.
And there was just nothing we could do to get anything done, and I had to work and you had to work, and there was no way to fix that. So we'll make it up to you at some point in the future, give you an extra episode one week when we get our lives figured out. but a couple episodes ago, we were talking about the Great Miss Bish, and we were talking about the Lincoln Hotel. And I went and did some research, and we're going to talk today about that on Storytelling on the Plains. So we've talked about a few of the people who live in this area and a little bit of the history of the land. But today we're just going to talk about a building. It's one that's been in Scotts Bluff for more than 100 years.
Yep.
I forgot what I was going to say.
I don't know if it's the oldest building still, like, as far as like standing structures. I don't think it's by far the oldest building we have here, because I think
there's a few smaller ones, but it's definitely the biggest and the most well known.
Well, was it a jail that's by the high school across from the old park? And I thought that was the oldest, one of the oldest.
Oh, the one
here
that's the
county.
National Guard building now, or
no? It's just an empty stone building with a.
Well, we should probably go look.
Yeah, I assumed it was the old jail.
We should probably go learn about that.
We should probably figure that out.
Because now we got people sitting here going, oh.
And probably some waving their hands like, I know what that is. I know exactly what he's talking about.
Yes, just email us.
Just email us.
And let us know.
It was my guess that it was a jail. It looks like a jail.
And I'm going to be drinking my tea this week because Paul made me some tea. And he made me some last time. And it sat on the desk the whole time. And then I had iced tea by the time we were done doing the podcast. So I'll make a point of taking that. So most people that live in the area don't really give much thought to this large brick building in downtown Scotts Bluff. Some people know that it used to be a hotel, but most don't know its history or purpose today. And I'm talking about that building that's known today as the Lincoln House. But when it was built a century ago, it was known as the Lincoln Hotel. The Nebraska Hotel Company was the company behind the hotel. They had built a hotel in Lincoln and decided they wanted other hotels across the state. And that makes sense. If you think about today when you travel, frequent travelers like certain hotels. Maybe they got some extra perks or free stays. Or you just like the way a certain chain is run and you know what to expect and what you're going to receive when you stay at Brand X Hotel. I know that I'm kind of partial. Growing up as a kid in New York, you didn't go to Motel 8 because they had hourly rates, and I'm just going to leave it there. So no matter where you went in the U.S., we weren't staying at a Motel 8.
Fair enough. I've stayed in several throughout my life.
Well, if you also remember, too, as a kid, my mom was traveling with me and my sister and my grandma and my aunt. And my aunt's only 6 years older than me. So you got five women in the 70s and early 80s traveling. They were kind of sketchy back then.
Yeah.
So we...
Back then.
All right. Still.
I still think they're pretty sketchy. Okay. Depends on which ones you go to, I suppose.
So, you know, those were off limits. But there's, you know, if you're going to stay to Hilton, you have a certain expectation.
Correct.
Just staying there. And so it makes sense that this company wanted to have a bunch of hotels across the street, across the state. Because if you say, hey, I stayed at a Nebraska hotel company in Lincoln and we're going to Scotts Bluff, I want to stay at that place because I know what I'm going to get. So the company's goal was to have six other hotels in smaller communities across the state. Scotts Bluff definitely fit that bill. The plan was to make the Lincoln Hotel the premier hotel for anyone who came to Scotts Bluff. The Nebraska Hotel Company wanted your money and planned to pull out all the stops for anyone arriving in town. They wanted them to just think Lincoln Hotel. And it kind of worked. So planning for the hotel began on February 7th, 1917, after the Nebraska Hotel Company met with the Scotts Bluff Commercial Club. The concrete skeleton of the hotel was completed in March 1918. However, there were a few people who I guess didn't like this idea and took to causing some damage. According to the application for the hotel to the National Register of Historic Places in August 1918, that's a very, as someone who's a writer, that's a very poorly written sentence because that implies that it applied to be on the register in August 1918. No, the application occurred much, much later. But in August 1918, vandals wedged wooden blocks into the outlet pipes for a large water tank on the roof, causing minor interior damage, but not delaying the project appreciably. If you want to read the application, it's 28 pages, and I'll put it on our Patreon page, and it's a PDF. You can download it. I'm going to read a little bit from an article from the Nebraska or the National Park Service. I can't talk today either. I'm at a practice after skipping a week. that's okay. So constructed from 1917 to 1918, the Lincoln Hotel is a local landmark in the south portion of the Central Business District in Scotts Bluff. Architect A. Bandy designed the six-story building for the Nebraska Hotel Company. For years, the hotel was a source of civic pride and an emblem of material and cultural accomplishment in the rapidly developing city. The Lincoln Hotel is an important example of early 20th century classical revival commercial architecture in the region. The six-story building stands out from the low-scale commercial buildings around it and derives its exterior architectural distinction from its classical revival facades. The hotel is supported by a reinforced concrete frame with integrally poured columns, beams, and slabs forming a uniform grid. The frame is expressed externally as spandrel beams and columns on the east and south walls. Here it is infilled with brick panels. The brick is laid as certain curtain walls on the north and west facades, hiding the concrete structure. The hotel has a flat roof with decorative terracotta and brick parapets bordering three sides. The historic importance of the Lincoln Hotel lies in its association with the hotel industry and more specifically the Nebraska Hotel Company. During the 1910s, modern hotels penetrated secondary markets of smaller Nebraska towns. Local communities pursued hotel companies such as the Nebraska Hotel Company to develop hotels in their towns. These grand hotels were a source of civic pride and prestige for many townspeople. And the Lincoln Hotel in Scotts Bluff was no different. When approached with the opportunity to develop a first-class hotel, the Scotts Bluff residents courted and even donated money to the Nebraska Hotel Company entrepreneurs. After opening in 1918, the Lincoln Hotel immediately became a centerpiece of Scotts Bluff commercial and social life. Advertised as mighty like a home, it hosted the majority of overnight visitors in the town and fed a steady stream of travelers and townspeople in the Lincoln restaurant on the first floor. The basement of the hotel boasted a beauty parlor for women and a cigar shop for men. Meanwhile, the Scotts Bluff room on the sixth floor was the scene of numerous social events and served as the meeting hall for numerous community organizations. So what the National Park Service refers to as the Scotts Bluff room is the ballroom up there on the top floor. Everybody Wow. refers to it as the ballroom because although there were lots and lots of dinners there, there were also lots of dances, and so more people remember it as a place you went to dance.
Well, 1918, that's coming on to the end of the war, World War One, anyway.
Yeah.
So a lot of soldiers probably coming back.
And when you look at the Lincoln Hotel today, and Connor and I will do our best to describe the photos we have here.
It's kind of interesting because I guess the photos don't quite do it justice because, I mean,
because really they're all black and white.
It's just a square brick building. You know, what is it, six-story?
Yeah.
Six-story square building. It doesn't have a grand facade at the opening like you see in a lot of hotels. Maybe it used to. If you look at the entrance, even the entrance today, it's not like a very grand-looking entrance.
No. The pictures from, I believe it was 98, application went in. The application was what date? February 6, 1998. So if you look at these photos, and I'll try to remember to put those up on our Patreon as well. And you look at the main entrance and the entrance on the north side of the building, that would be the one that's away from the on the other side of the Star Herald. You can see even then in the picture that the entrance kind of has that 70s and 80s feel to it.
Yeah, it almost just looks like an office.
Yeah, so it's not quite the same. And when you look at those pictures as well, I noted, and I know this because I worked at the Star Herald and saw this every single day. When you look at the side of the building, where you like I just read, there's, you know, facades on three sides. Yeah, and so we're like looking on the fourth side that doesn't have that.
It almost looks like it's meant for another building to be next to it, and that's just the alley.
Yeah, and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's 6 little panels here. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're rather large panels. They're like 6 feet tall, maybe maybe taller. But if I remember correctly, and I'm kind of guessing here, it's the third or the fourth one. There's an entrance there now.
Oh, okay.
And so when this was taken, that entrance was not there. I believe that's part of when they finally converted it to the apartments that we're going to get to here in a minute. But there were offices in there in addition to being a hotel. Even the front of the hotel today looks different than in these photos.
Yeah, they spiffied it up, but it's still nothing grand. It doesn't have like a bunch of columns kind of jutting out that makes you like lead to the entrance of a bank.
Yeah, yeah. So,
so it is that old style. What do they call it? Classic. That was a big word you said. Classic. Blah 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 blah.
Yeah.
It really is only on the very top, like the top of filigree or what would you call that? Decoration.
Yeah, the decoration along the top, and then that top sixth floor, there's a little bit.
Yeah, there looks like there's crests.
But most of it is gone. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that was on purpose or just with age.
So was there probably more to it? Or was this...
I think this was it. This is what it looked like. And this close-up picture of the building, you can kind of see some more of the detail, but yeah. It's still, I mean, it still does kind of scream to me like early 20th century. Mm-hmm. And maybe they thought later on they might put something more in, but they didn't. And that's one thing they're doing on the Midwest Theater, and maybe we should do an episode on that. And I'm sure... because I used to work with the guy that's their marketing person. I'm sure I could text him and be like, dude, come over and talk to us about the Midwest. But they're almost done with their refurbishment of the front. Oh, wow. And they're restoring it to what it looked like in its heyday. And that's, gosh, that's taken almost a year, a little more than a year to get it done. And there's a lady that's inside. I think she's done now. She was doing some restoration on the wall paintings and
everything
stuff
on that stage, which is it does look marvelous. And that is something that, to my knowledge, has not changed.
No, it's mostly the same. And I think a lot of it is they're just restoring the outside to what it looked like, because when it wasn't a regular theater anymore, it kind of deteriorated a little bit. And then they got the Friends of the Midwest together, opened the theater back up, and now they don't get first-run shows, and I'm trying to remember, there's a long process where they fall in the pecking order of getting movies, but sometimes
they... did a lot of really good ones last year.
Yeah.
They did Rocky Horror Picture Show during Halloween. They also did all of, I can't think of, like Spaceballs and Blazing mm-hmm. Saddles and all that. They did like a weekend of that, and they actually... they did the Mario movie.
Yeah.
Which so is kind of a newer movie.
So they can get what's, we would call them new movies, but there's a pecking order, and it'd be first run. So like your AMC theaters, your draft houses mm-hmm. get first pick on the new movies that come out. And I believe the Midwest is like fifth or sixth down on that line. And so they'll put in a request and they'll say, hey, we want this new Super Mario Brothers movie. And it might be 2 months, 3 months after it opens before they can get it. But somewhere down the line, they'll be able to get it.
Going to the theater is kind of a novelty thing now.
Yeah.
I don't really go.
I used to go to the movies all the time. I mean, probably mm-hmm. 30, 40, 50 times a year.
Oh, yeah.
And then as I got older, it was less and less, but I still went to the theater every year. And since COVID hit... I just don't want to, I mean,
kill theater.
Yeah, really I just don't want to go to the theater anymore. So my husband and I wait and we watch it at home. And it works pretty well because, you know, I have some mental health issues and being around lots of people is tough. And I managed to do it all those years. But then I had, it's now, what, a 3-year break of, well, 2020, 21, 22, and halfway through 23. So close to a 4-year break of not going to the movies. And I just can't do it anymore, and I don't have to. Yeah, so
you don't even have to wait that long.
No, it's usually a few weeks now. Yeah. So back to the Lincoln Hotel. Since we got way, way off. Well,
might as well just go to the theater.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's Connor and Irene. We're never going to stay on topic. So construction on the Lincoln Hotel was finished in October 1918. The next step was to have a big old party and celebrate its opening. So the commercial club thought, let's do a New Year's Eve party. Sure, why not? It was billed as an extravaganza because not only was this an awesome new hotel opening, but according to the historical places application, the influenza quarantine was also being lifted at that time. So people have been stuck in their homes.
Yeah, much recently, like what we were talking
about. Yeah, and they can now go out and party, have fun, hang out with other people. So if you remember in our episode about the Great Miss Bish, the flu pandemic shut everything down. People couldn't and didn't want to go anywhere near anyone else for fear of catching the flu. They didn't want to give it to a family member or pass it along to anyone who could possibly die from it. And I get that. I have some... the word is in my head and I can see it and I can't say it. Compromised immune system.
There you go.
So I was very hesitant to be around people, and right now it's June 2023, and it was about a month ago that I stopped wearing a mask when I went out places because I know the potential dangers for me, and it could be worse for someone who doesn't have a compromised immune system, but I didn't want to take that chance. Yeah. So I can see where these folks also didn't want to take a chance because there wasn't a vaccine, you got it, and it was...
Well, and there wasn't really, wasn't a mask-up policy either. I don't think the flu was really understood that way.
People did mask, and I have seen pictures of people masked out here. But again, they were all just makeshift masks. It's not like
cloth, just kind of put over your mouth.
And hope for the best. So they had the right idea because
they were covering their faces.
Yeah, if you get into the science of it all, it did help a little bit. But you know, they didn't have the scientifically advanced masks that we have today that can stop many different kinds of particulates. So I get them wanting to go out and have some fun. So in a way, it's kind of remarkable that the Nebraska Hotel Company and the Scotts Bluff Commercial Club thought the hotel would be a good idea, because you're in the middle of a terrible, life-threatening virus spreading all over the world, and your first thought is, hey, let's build a place for lots of people gather.
Yeah, they're all about the future. I think they knew that it wouldn't last forever.
Yeah, and maybe they knew, you know, at that point in time it was dying. Not that the flu has really ever died out, because it still kills tens of thousands of people every year. But maybe they had access to info that regular folks didn't, and was like, you know, this isn't going to last forever.
Or maybe the pessimist in me would say the richer folk got less sick than the poor folk, and therefore, what were they worried about?
And I think you're being more of a realist there than a pessimist. So, you know, in hindsight, they were right, but I sure would have loved to have been there when they were talking about what they were doing and their plans for all of this stuff. So the hotel is officially built, and 6 weeks later, everybody's planning a party. The official grand opening of the hotel was held on December 31st, 1918. And we already talked about Miss Bish in a previous episode, but she was there singing and dancing. Also, in that episode, we talked about her orange dress. And I had written in my notes here that you can see it at Legacy of the Plains. It's off display right now.
Yeah, we didn't see it. Yeah. Unfortunately.
So, I'm sure if I asked Dave tomorrow, he'd show it to me, but, you know, we might need to build up a little bit of rapport with him. Because I left the Star-Herald not too long after he took over as director, and the previous directors that had been there, I literally could call them up and be like, hey, show me this stuff. And okay, and they'd get it all pulled out, let me take pictures, tell me the history of it, and I
have to say, everyone that I've so far talked to, that you've introduced me to, have been incredibly kind and friendly and just want to sit down and tell you everything. Mm-hmm. They want to show you.
Yeah.
I mean, I think they find it very lonely being archivists. I don't think a lot of people go up there and just ask them. So, yeah. And I encourage everyone here to do that. Go bug those ladies.
Yeah.
I think they'd enjoy it.
They love doing it. And mm-hmm. they have some programs where I thought about maybe when I retire, if the program's still running, they got a program called Puzzles of the Past. Mm-hmm. And they have bits of information, and it might just be a picture. What the heck is this picture? Where is it? What's going mm-hmm. on? They've done it on towns that don't exist anymore and gather information and pictures and get the history of the town. So they do all that, and then the archivist puts it all together in a file so that when people like you and me come and say, hey, I want to do a story on X. Oh, yeah, we got a whole file on that. Mm-hmm. It's an amazing resource if you're looking for history out here.
Yeah. And like I said, I encourage people not only to go see it, but definitely go out and do your best to donate and try to keep all those people in business.
Yeah.
I mean, they have to make a living too. And it's really hard to do that as a living.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So back to our hotel again.
Back to the hotel.
So the opening was a huge deal for this whole area. The museum legacy also houses some of the dinner plates used in the banquet room, which could seat 187 people. And
I don't remember seeing that either. But
there
is a lot. There's so much to see.
They
there.
Used to be in the display case when you first walked into the museum. And if you walk in the front doors and you turn right, you're going to walk into the women's restroom. Mm-hmm. And then the display case was on the wall between the women's and the men's restroom.
Oh, okay.
That's where it used to be, and I totally spaced off even looking at that. So, again, we'll have to go back there. But they do have some of the dinner plates used in the banquet room, which could seat 187 people. They also have some envelopes from invitations, which tout Scott's Bluff as the largest irrigated valley in the United States. And going through Scott's Bluff is the shortest route to Yellowstone and other national parks. I don't know if either one of those are true now, but at least in 1918 it was.
Because we really didn't have the interstate system till after World War II, right? If my memory serves.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah the Eisenhower state system, yeah.
Yeah, it probably was the quickest route at that time.
So, and I honestly, I didn't want to sit on Google Maps doing routes to Yellowstone to figure out what the shortest one is. I'm just assuming they were right in 1918. I hate math. Anyone wants to sit and figure out all those calculations, have at it.
Well, and even if they weren't right, it's good advertisement, right?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, you think about it, if you go from east to west across South Dakota, how many signs do you see for Wall, South Dakota, and free water?
Yep. Wall drug.
Yes, wall drug.
Yeah. Have you been to Wall Drug?
I have. And
did you get your free water?
Yes, I did. Yes,
and
I
your,
did.
And your, what, 5 cents
Five-cent coffee, yep.
And donuts.
And and there's a giant jackalope there, and somewhere in this room with my pictures, I have a picture of Paul sitting on this giant jackalope. And yes, his parents are from England, so I forgive them for falling for the jackalope is real. thing.
Oh, they actually fell for it, did they?
Yeah, we had to explain, yeah, that's not real.
Yeah, for our listeners who've never heard what a jackalope is, it's, of course, a rabbit mixed with an antelope, so it's like a rabbit with horns. Is the basic picture that I usually get.
And I want to go back up there solely so I can get another little jackalope, because Paul had one for the longest time. Mm-hmm. And we, at that point in time, we were living in Lincoln, and then we moved to Binghamton for him to get his master's degree, then North Carolina to teach, then Poughkeepsie, New York to teach, and then back out here. And somewhere in that, we lost it. And so I would love to get him another little jackalope.
And they'd sell you, they'll really try for it to fool you around here. They'll give you like skeletons, like skulls of rabbits with horns on them, like horns just glued on there. They'll really sell you if you let them. And as soon as you admit that even that it could be real, they hooked you and they'll start reeling you in.
Oh gosh, I haven't come across anybody like that yet. Probably because I was super skeptical, and I'm going, that's not real. And this was in 1998 when I was on the internet, but the internet did not come with me when I traveled, so I couldn't look it up. The internet
has proven it more to be real than not real. Now, I don't think the internet's helped with debunking the jackalope. Oh, gosh.
Okay. Yeah, I guess it was good that I was skeptical.
Yeah.
So, of course, the Scotts Bluff Star-Herald newspaper interviewed a bunch of folks at the opening night of the hotel, and everyone bragged that the hotel was awesome. And what sells newspapers but a story about how the area is going to be changed by this awesome new business? I have literally written stories like that. The paper wrote about how the hotel had 80 rooms and the hotel was fireproof, and that intrigued me because the very first time I came, I did a story actually for the hotel's 100th birthday, and when I came across the fact that, you know, everyone's like, yeah, this is awesome hotel, it's going to put us on the map, da 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 da, like, okay, I've actually written those stories, whatever, quote. Here's my story. But when I found out that the hotel was fireproof, I was like, how do you make a whole hotel fireproof in 1918?
But it was that steel and concrete structure.
Yeah. But at the time when I had read that, I didn't know anything else about the hotel. That article from 100 years ago was like the first or second thing that I read about the hotel. So I'm going, what? And then I learned about how it was
interesting because in New York, a lot of the famous skyscrapers were starting to be built because of this design, the steel and concrete design. That was all brand new.
And now it's old hat. You just look at it and you're like, eh.
Yeah. Now it's getting into 3D printed stuff.
I don't know if I want to live in a 3D printed hotel, though.
I've seen a couple of them out south. They've been doing a lot because you can do, of course, concrete, and you don't have to do much else other than concrete.
Okay. Like an shell?
Adobe style, okay. Kind of house. But it's a 3D printer. They set it up in the middle of the house, and it works just like a 3D printer. It slowly goes around and around and around and around, putting layer after layer after layer of the house together. It's remarkable.
Cool.
I think it's really, really neat. So that's going to be our future. We're just going to have these giant machines whipping out houses.
If we don't kill ourselves first. See, there's the pessimist in me.
Well, they'll still be making the houses. We just won't be there.
Yeah,
there they won't you know go. When to quit.
So one official was quoted in the paper as saying, as is rather forcefully expressed by the management, a bonfire may be built in any room, in any hallway, in any part of the building, and it will merely burn itself out. Really glad nobody ever took him up on that offer. Yeah. So the December 31st, 1918 Star-Herald noted the building was concrete and stone are not conducive, or are not, let me start that over.
Not conducive?
Conductive. The December 31st, 1918 Star Herald noted that the building was concrete and stone and are not conductive to spectacular conflagrations.
But isn't the floor still made out of wood?
I just love how everybody used big words to say, nah, this place ain't catching on fire. They probably should have put...
Titanic's unsinkable and yep.
Yeah. They probably also should have had a little footnote that said, please don't try. Thankfully, nobody did. So the same edition of the paper also stated a new era in Scott's Bluff was being ushered in. And I didn't write the journalist's name, but they... Do you have something to say?
No, I was just saying, I think, again, it's because of the architecture. It's that the way they were... how fast this building probably went up was probably remarkable.
It went up in about a year.
Yeah, which a structure that size in a year is incredible.
Yeah, you're really not getting that now. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to think of the car wash. Mm-hmm. That's been over a year now.
Yeah, I don't know why they're dragging their heels on that one.
Yeah, I mean, it's a car wash.
Yeah.
Why are you taking so long?
But this building, I think that gave us a little taste of the East. Because like I said, New York was going up. All these wonderful buildings were being made. And also in Chicago, there mm-hmm. were all these structures were being built. And I think we got a little taste of that here. Kind of got a little proud.
Imagine if Scotts Bluff had become like, maybe not as big as Chicago or New York City, but a big city. If it had been the main city in the state rather than Lincoln or Omaha.
It would have been interesting.
It would have been really cool to see. So the newspaper wrote, there's my editor. If he's listening, he'll be like, Irene, newspapers can't write. So one of the journalists wrote in the paper, the opening of the magnificent new hostelry, and I'm not even sure.
Hostelry?
I 100 years ago, maybe that was normal. The opening of the magnificent new hostelry brought out a record-breaking crowd for a banquet hosted by the commercial club in the sixth-floor ballroom. The reporter attested, the old days have been left behind, and that for the future the city will look upon matters from an angle which has been made possible by the metropolitan setting furnished in the new hostelry. So there, all the cool things you just said, but they used all these big words they didn't need to.
Big words.
Yeah.
Who needs big words?
I mean, there's a time and a place for the big words, but that's one of the things you're always taught. You want to make sure that your audience understands what you're writing, and I think people forget that sometimes. Even 100 years ago, there were people reading the newspaper that didn't know what some of these words were.
I love Mark Twain, but I don't want to speak like Mark Twain.
Oh, God.
He uses all these big
All those
words.
Flowery words that you don't need
very
to.
Flowery words.
And I write, I remember my former editor, Bart, told me one time, because Bart writes, if you want to put it on a level system, he's a little bit above me. He writes more intellectually. Mm-hmm. And I write to make sure people understand what I'm trying to explain. Yep. And every now and then I'll use a big word because that's the specific word and the specific definition that I'm going for. But I try not to use those words because I want people to understand the story and the message I'm trying to convey. Mm-hmm. And he's writing to a more literary audience. So his writing serves a purpose and my writing serves a purpose.
Oh, absolutely.
And I could do that literary stuff, but I don't like to do it. It's not me. It's not natural. Mm-hmm. And I want everybody from, a 10-year-old kid to a 90-year-old person to be able to read and understand exactly what I'm trying to say. And that can get lost sometimes in flowery words.
Lowry.
So if you get a chance to look in the archives of the Legacy of the Plains Museum, there's another plug. God, these guys should be paying us.
No kidding.
There's a photograph of the inside of the banquet hall on April 19th, 1928. It's a picture of the junior-senior prom at Scotts Bluff High School. Be forewarned, though, it's quite the racist photo. The theme of the prom was Native American. And if you know the history of the area and you look at the photo, the depictions aren't even of the tribes who were native to the area. And I'm kind of smiling and chuckling here, but they didn't think there was anything wrong with it in 1928. If they did that same thing today, oh,
well, but up until the 90s.
Yeah.
I mean, when did we really start to kind of make headway on that as finally coming to terms
as
a community that that's not right?
Because the AIM movement was 70s, right? When they took over Alcatraz. And I heard things then as a little kid. Yeah, you're probably right. 90s is when there started to be a little bit of pushback of that this isn't cool.
Well, and we didn't really have the great revoking of the mascots until later in the 2000s, 2010s.
Yeah. And no one thought anything of the late 80s, early 90s with the Atlanta Braves and their tomahawk chop.
Yeah.
Nobody really, I kind of was like, that doesn't seem right, but I didn't really quite get why. And it wasn't until a few years later that I understood why.
Yeah.
So, well,
and it's still engraved into our culture to this day of the white man took over the natives, and that's the way it was. It's not to use it bluntly, cowboys and Indians. It was the old school way of doing things.
Mm-hmm. And even when I moved here, probably 2009, 2010, I was working in one of the school districts, and one of the teachers there, literally just said, you know what? People conquer people and kill them. Get over it. And I'm going, okay.
Just make sure you remember that when you're being conquered.
And I didn't say anything because, you know, I had just moved to the area and this was the first person that had come up with something like that. And I'm going, what? And on top of that, they said it in front of the class. So it would have been a teacher and me being a para arguing in front of kids. So I'm just like, I'm not touching it. Yeah. I'm like, I'm not going there.
And for those who are interested in this picture, it'd be the Scotts Bluff High School in 1928, what would now be the middle school, I believe, correct?
Yes. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. And they had their prom up there at the Lincoln Hotel. So also in that photo, you can see how fancy dinners looked at the time. And from a historical perspective, it's pretty cool to see that. If you ever get to go inside the current building, they have kept a few historical artifacts, including a picture of the ballroom from opening night when it was full of folks enjoying the dinner. And it's this big, huge panoramic photo. Oh.
They had terrible racist parties, but hey, their China was really fancy.
Thanks, Connor. I was trying to skip right past that. if you enter from the west entrance, which is on Broadway, and walk into the building and stride across the room into the wall, the picture's right there. So it's pretty easy to see,
so you can walk in. No, you can't. Okay. I was saying.
If you can go in or know someone who lives there. And we'll get to that in a minute why you can't. but I had the privilege as a reporter, the site manager took me all over and showed me cool things, and they still have that hanging, and there's some chandeliers hanging as well. Oh, it was awesome. And the thing that sucks is all of the pictures I took for my story on the hotel or the building's 100th anniversary, so they belong to the paper, so I can't share them without permission from the Star Herald because they own them, and I'm pretty sure they would say no. So Maybe, you know, I might have to figure out who the manager is now, and maybe they might let us go in one day and walk around and see and take some pictures. But that would have to be something for the future. So the hotel also had its own cigar store, which was, you know, not for me, because women don't smoke, apparently. But it had a beauty shop, because, you know, men don't need a beauty shop. Only women need a beauty shop, and only men need a cigar shop.
Yep, this was still, although, getting into the 1920s is when suffrages and the suffrage movement really became a thing.
And the roaring 20s, so maybe you did have women going in there and buying some cigars from the cigar shop.
And you had prohibition, so I don't know how much that affected the cigar sales.
Yeah. And that information I was also finding from, you know, early 20s information. Mm-hmm. So it could have been written by someone who didn't want women in cigar shops. So,
well, as far as I know, they still weren't allowed in cigar shop. Like, cigar parlors, from what I understood back then, were only for men.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure. Just like saloons were only for men as well. The women really weren't allowed in bars until after Prohibition. Well, during Prohibition, actually, that's where the flapper girls and all that came from. But yeah, it was very, very segregated back then.
And there's an amusing story which has been passed down, and I was told by several employees at the Legacy of the Plains Museum, and I was told this when I was doing the original research on its 100th birthday, so I'm just going to quote from that article. One of the many humorous stories in the building's history involves one of the first cooks, a German from Russia woman. As the story goes, in the 1920s, a married man in management tried to begin a relationship with her. She cut off his shirt with a knife and took the shirt to his wife. And everyone who has told me that story ends it with, "You can imagine what happened next." And I don't think anybody knows what happened next, and that's why you get that bit. But yeah, I guess they're lucky all she did was cut off his shirt. But I guess that would be one way of proving he was doing something, was, "Hey, here's your husband's shirt. How do you think I got it?" there's also a cool picture down at Legacy of the Plains Museum, taken by a 12-year-old girl in 1925. The previous director showed me this little postcard. Not postcard, this little picture, but it looks like a postcard. She was taking candid shots while visiting Scott's Bluff, and her family was driving down the road, and she snapped a picture of the hotel. And the neat thing is you can see different windows are open.
Oh.
Because, you know, all the promotional stuff, the windows are closed and stuff. And so it's just this neat little candid snapshot of 1925 when her family drove past the hotel. So I like those neat little, here's a snapshot in time of what was going on. When you're actually able to see or hold artifacts from that time, it also kind of takes you back, and you can imagine what it was like that night. I can't, because I always fall asleep around 10 o'clock on New Year's Eve, so I don't really have good reference points for what New Year's Eve parties are like, because I'm asleep by midnight. And I'm also not going to wear any frilly or fancy dress to any kind of New Year's Eve thing. I'm going to show up in a t-shirt and jeans, and if that's not acceptable, I'm going home and going to sleep, which I'm probably going to do anyway. The last time I wore a dress was at my friend's wedding, and that's because she's Greek, and then my other friend is Dutch. And the Greek Orthodox Church in Rotterdam,
they won't let you in.
Yeah. I think she gave me like 6 or 7 months leeway to find something. And I managed to find a skirt, and it sucked so bad. I could not wait to... And I wore a pair of men's boxer shorts underneath that skirt.
See, I'm personally the exact opposite. I think men should wear much, much more skirts. I think the Scottish had it right. There it's you much go. More free. Yeah.
I think you should wear whatever you're comfortable with.
There you go.
You know? And you know, as long as you're not naked. And I mean, granted, you should be able to walk around naked too, but, you know, people are going to say stuff. I'm not going to walk around naked. But I think, you know, if you think, hey, that shirt, that skirt, that those pants, those shoes, I like those, buy them and wear them.
Yeah. Yeah, why not?
And, yeah. I'm not going to go there anymore. Getting back to 1921 at the hotel, that's when things started to change. And I'm going to read again from the National Park Service, who did a lot of research into the hotel. In 1921, the Lincoln Hotel's parent company, the Nebraska Hotel Company, filed for bankruptcy. So They get this built between 1917 and 1918, and it's 1921 and they're filing bankruptcy. That same year, ownership of the Lincoln Hotel passed to hotel entrepreneur Eugene Epley. Epley's hotel empire oversaw management of the Lincoln until 1956, when he sold the hotel to the Sheraton Mid-Continent Group. Shortly thereafter, Sheraton sold the hotel to the Fields Nebraska Corporation, and less than 5 years later, the Fields Nebraska Corporation declared bankruptcy, and the control of the hotel fell into the hands of a series of short-term proprietors who allowed the hotel to deteriorate. So it worked okay for a while, but, you know, nothing can survive constant changing of hands.
Yeah, constant changing hands. Well, and at that time, Scott's Bluff was constantly changing. We had the sugar boom, and the sugar bust had already pretty much gone on by then.
Yeah.
And that changed Scott's Bluff a lot.
And when we do a story on, I was looking at some old stuff I have done to research on. If I remember correctly, I think it was triple. Scott's Bluff and Gehring's population tripled.
It did.
It was overnight.
At one time, it was the largest growing city in America for a short amount of time. Mm-hmm. We made the record there. But yeah, that was the famous sugar boom.
Yeah. So not everything was so sad, though. With all that development of hotels across the state, including the Lincoln Hotel, another necessity to people's health was needed. So two other hotels had been under construction on 18th Street. The North Hotel on 15th Street was the South Hotel. So that's...
you were just talking about how us Westerners just really weren't very good at coming up with unique names for streets and stuff. It's like, 19th, 15th Street, and, on the 19th Street on the north side of that building.
So it was... That stuff still confuses me, even though I sat down and wrote this so that it was not confusing. So there were two hotels under construction. The one on 18th Street was the North Hotel, and the one on 15th Street was the South Hotel. So both buildings were located on Broadway, which was the main strip in town, and it still... Well, I don't know if it is anymore. My husband would say Food Row is, which is 27th Street. I don't really know if there's a main strip anymore because, you know, working overnights at the shelters, you can listen to the boy racers race down Broadway, turn onto 27th Street, race down 27th Street, and then come back, and they do that till like 2 o'clock in the morning. So maybe it's both now. But
well, at one point I understood... Overland to be,
you know, Overland was hopping for a long time too.
That was the main strip. It was in Overland, and then from Overland it went right into Broadway. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't now. They cut that section.
Yeah, do you remember that? That was not mm-hmm. long after I moved here, and when they were planning on cutting that off, people went nuts.
They were not happy.
Oh, they were. Oh, I was.
And that was also though the time where Broadway was double laned on both sides, so. That's where That's where they used to do the drag races, all the young teenagers.
Them young whippersnappers. So with the flu pandemic, everyone in town felt a hospital was a bigger priority than more hotels. So it was
figure.
Yeah. So it was decided whichever one was completed first was going to become the hospital. So on April 15, 1924, the West Nebraska Methodist Episcopal Hospital opened at the corner of 18th and Broadway. That is a mouthful, and I just don't see a Methodist Episcopal Hospital opening today. It's just going to be one Christian denomination. You're not getting two in there.
It is interesting how they got together
and,
to get it done, but they still do that a lot in our communities. Our local churches do
that's true.
Get together a lot to make stuff happen.
Yeah.
For better or for worse.
True. So a staff of 25 welcomed the first seven patients that day. And according to information from Regional West Medical Center, they have way more detail on this because they trace their history back to that hospital. Mm-hmm. So when that hospital became St. Mary's and then became Regional West. And so they traced their lineage all the way back to that because each of the subsequent hospitals were bigger expansions. Mm-hmm. So that area where the hospital was is now the 18th Street Plaza, which was officially completed a few weeks ago. And that's been in the process for 8-9 years to turn that area into the plaza. When I moved here in 2007, the city would just shut the street down on Saturdays for the farmers market, but they were already talking about a plaza. And I need to dig out my old stories, but there was an older building in that area as well, which was demolished to make room for the plaza once 18th Street between Broadway and First Avenue was closed. But that street was closed off quite often to hold events, to hold farmers markets. You know, Bands on Broadway is down there now. Mm-hmm. And it took a while to get the plaza done, but it's done. And I can't remember the name of the building, but I got to go in and tour. They were going to try and restore the building or save the building and then use it as like an activities checkout mm-hmm. building. Oh my God, it was so bad because again, it got neglected for so long. Yeah. They just couldn't save it. So I took pictures inside and outside and I was like a little kid with, oh my God, look, there's a bulldozer. Oh, there's this other machine. Oh, there's this other machine. And I spent probably 5 hours there one day while they were demolishing the building, taking pictures and did a story on it because it was just, it's the coolest thing to me. It's not often that I can stand literally next to this machine with a hard hat on while they're demolishing the building and just yell up to the guy driving it, okay, why are you doing it this way? Why did you go in this way and not just do this? And then he would explain the physics to me of, oh, if we did it this way, it's going to fall that way and kill some people. So we have to do it this way so it falls in on us. And it was just, it's one of the cool things of being a reporter is you get to learn those cool little things. So anyway, over time, the hotel lost its luster. Highway 26 was built, and a bunch of motels popped up along the highway to take advantage of people passing through. It's a little over a mile from Highway 26 to the hotel's location, but really, even today, most people are just going to grab what they see along the way.
Yeah, there's no reason to go into town if you're on Highway 26. You're usually just passing through.
Yeah, because if you're heading west to east, you're going to come into town, you're going to see Maverick Gas Station, Chili's is across the street. Mm-hmm. If you happen to look while you're filling up gas, you might see Taco John's. Otherwise, you're going to drive down the road a little bit more, you're going to see Perkins, you'll drive a little bit more, you'll see Sherry's, and then there's another gas station. It's got that old Corvette on top of it.
Yep.
They got a sub shop inside, and then there's on your way out on the edge of town, is it Essential Oils? It's a Sinclair station.
It's a Sinclair station.
And they got a Witch Witch sandwich shop there. So you're not going to come into Scotts Bluff. And along that way, you're passing, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 hotels on the highway. So you're not going to go looking for something else.
Well, and then it hooks up. Now it hooks up to Highway 26, hooks up to the Heartland Express.
Mm-hmm.
That'll take you all the way up down to Mexico and then all the way up to Canada.
Yeah.
At least that was the idea.
Yeah, yeah. So you're just not going to come into town. And even if they only had one hotel out there, you're going to stay at that hotel rather than come in, because you'd have to come down Avenue B, turn off Avenue B to 27th, and then go down Broadway to get to the hotel. It's very easy to get lost. So so even though the hotel's popularity declined and people stopped staying there, the building wasn't doomed. A lot of people were still interested in the building and its architecture. There were also quite a few changes. In the 1960s, facades were changed or pulled out entirely. So that answers your question there, Connor.
So there was a lot more.
Yeah.
It looks like there was more to it than what you see nowadays.
Yeah. And if you look at photographs from when it was built, which I only have descriptions, to the 60s, which are all these ones that I got printed up, there's to today, even 60s to today, the outside is definitely striking. You're like, yeah, that's not there anymore. That's not there anymore. And some things look better and some things look worse.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if they'll ever change anything again. Who knows? So I'm going to reference the application for it to be placed on the historic register, because they describe what it was like when it was built. And I had to look up some of these terms because I'm not an architect, so I hope I got all this right. So the outside is described as having dressed limestone slabs, brick columns, and neoclassical terracotta entablature. Today it is covered by epoxy stone panels and fixed sash windows in a brushed aluminum frame. An entablature is the superstructure of moldings and bands which lies horizontally above columns resting on their capitals, which are the tops.
just Google it, folks.
Entablatures are major elements of classical architecture and are commonly divided into the architrave, the frieze, and the cornice. So, yeah.
Did everyone get that?
Yeah. Y'all can go.
There'll be a test on this later.
Oh my God, that would be more work for me to do. So basically, the building looked awesome, and today it just looks like a big building in downtown. It still sticks out and hovers over all of downtown Scotts Bluff. Even with the changes, if you take a few moments to actually look at the structure, you can tell everyone involved in the project intended for the building to be this massive point everyone knew of and knew how to get to.
Uh-huh.
The inside wasn't spared either. Some of the key changes included yanking out the wood paneling in the lobby. The inside of the hotel had a stone and wood trim. Unfortunately, I think the original floors were replaced with carpet.
Boo.
I'm not a fan of carpet at all. So if you take a wood floor out of any building or house, I'm going to hate it.
Yeah.
We have seen pictures of our house about 10 years ago, and it had a wood floor, and we have carpet up there now.
Yeah.
I did go and pull the little vent thing out by my desk, and I think the wood floor is still there. So I'm working. Oh, I'm like, come on, Paul, we need to pull the carpet up. We need to pull it. Because if it's there, all we got to do is pull the carpet up, and we got a beautiful wood floor again.
Yeah.
I absolutely hate carpet. So that makes me mad that there's carpet there now. So from 1965 to 1971, the hotel was converted into dormitories and classrooms to be used by Hiram Scott College, and again from 1976 to 1983 by the Platte Valley Bible College. In the late 1990s, Metro Plains Development of St. Paul, Minnesota acquired the hotel and adaptively reconfigured the building for use as subsidized senior housing. Though only a shadow of what it was in its heyday, the Lincoln Hotel still stands as a testament to the ambition and determination of a young community attempting to define itself through the opulence and prestige associated with a grand hotel. The Lincoln House Apartments has 1 and 2 bedroom apartments. In addition to being senior housing, there are also certain income requirements you need to meet in order to live there. So there's a mix of young and old that live there today. They told me there are ongoing refurbishments to restore the building to its original condition, but I haven't been in it since 2017.
I don't see that happening.
Yeah, and
why would you do that for what's, Section 8 housing?
Yeah, and the building is secured, so you can't just walk in and wander around. The residents that live there will absolutely report you as a stranger or a weirdo or both and call the cops on you.
Yeah.
You're free to walk around the outside and look at it, though. And I learned that. I got to the step just before call the cops on you. They managed to get a hold of the hotel manager. And I didn't know this. I just walked in the building, went and knocked on the door. Nobody answered. So I'm like scrolling on my phone to find some contact info. And so the residents were not happy that this strange person was in the building. So please don't go do that. So they did put a new elevator in. I think it was 2017 when I was there doing this story. One of the elevators was broken, and I think they had just put a new one in, and the one that was broken they were trying to fix. And also the residents that live there have a little kitchenette and dining area on the second floor where they host dinners each month, so that's cool. That makes it like a little community. They also hold church services there on Sundays for residents because some of the residents don't have transportation, can't get out, so that's also kind of cool. And then the main lobby, there's a big old chandelier that they said they want to restore as well, and I would love to see if that ever happens. Again, the only pictures I have of it, I had to give to the Star Herald, so I just remember it was this really cool chandelier, and if they could fix it up, it'd be sweet. So I also got to go on the roof that day and take some awesome pictures. No one's allowed up there right now because it's not really safe. I didn't really feel too safe when I was up there. But if they could find a way to make it safe, it would be a really cool place to have, you know, some barbecues and stuff. Mm-hmm. And when I say not safe, literally most of the edge you would walk around on top, it's at ankle length. So if you take a step too far back one way, you're falling six stories. And, you know, I just don't think they ever thought anybody was going to go on the roof when they built it. Mm-hmm. There is a small section that's a bit higher, but it's still like mid-calf for me. That's still very easy to fall over. Oh, so it's not safe to go up there. It was just a privilege that day because of the story that I was doing, and the lady let me go up there and do it. And so the application I referred to throughout the podcast was accepted, and on March 5th, 1988, the Lincoln Hotel, now the Lincoln House, was accepted and placed on the National Register of Historic Places. So that's our story on the Lincoln Hotel.
Yeah, go check it out.
And walk around. Just don't look too creepy because somebody might call the cops on you. So thanks for listening, and we'll get back at you next week.
Thanks for listening to Storytelling on the Plains, a podcast about the history of Western Nebraska. If you enjoyed this episode, visit our website, storytellingontheplains.com, where you can subscribe to the show through a variety of podcast hosts so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to support the podcast, visit patreon.com/storytellingontheplains, where you can get the episodes early and bonus content.
You can also help promote the show by sharing the podcast with others, posting social media, or leaving us a rating on Apple Podcasts. Until next time, thanks for listening to Storytelling on the Plains.